Welcome back to Risk Check Podcast.
Episode 31.
Woo! Yeah. Super lit. We officially have over a month worth of content.
One for every day of the month.
Wow. So for all you people who are just joining us and tuning in, you get a lot to catch up on.
Yep.
But it's all good. Trust and believe. Much appreciated for those who have been supporting us. We love you. And continue to support. If you're watching us on YouTube, hit that subscribe button.
Please.
If you're watching us on Spotify, give us a 5-star rating.
Please.
If you're listening to us on Apple Podcasts or Google Podcasts, I'd also like a 5-star rating.
Please.
And get in contact with us. We're on Instagram, TikTok, etc. We got a special episode.
A very, very special
Shout out to Rashawn.
Shout out to Rashawn.
So if you're listening, Rashawn is not here.
He's still lost in the world somewhere.
Rashawn is Carmen Sandiego. He's playing that role. We're trying to figure out where he is. So we're going to share another image of Rashawn. Maybe you guys can guess where he is.
Yeah, we're going to put it right here this time.
This is where we're putting it. So shout out to Rashawn. We love you. We miss you. And can't wait for you to come back from vacation, your working vacation, and join us on the couch. But before that, so in his place, we have a friend of the pod, if you will,
yep,
who's guest co-hosting this week, Rafa.
Hey, guys. Happy to be here.
Glad to have you, sir. Excited. How's it feel to be back?
I loving it, man. I loved it the first time and wanted to get back on the couch.
Is better the second time.
Yeah.
Respect. And we have a special guest this evening whom we'll be interviewing and sharing his story. Ben, you want to introduce this guest for us?
Yeah, we have a very good friend of mine, a very serious, heavy hitting watch collector too.
Heavy.
Super duper heavy.
Super duper heavy. But also he has what I love about this guy, varied taste.
Yes.
And he buys what he likes, mm-hmm. and he's got a really amazing story.
Yep.
So please do the honors.
One half of the best sneaker store in New York City.
Let's get him.
Danny Arango, co-owner and co-founder of District One.
Let's go. Clap it up.
Yeah.
Thank you for joining us, my man.
Yeah, thank you for having me. I've been waiting for this for a while. I think we spoke about this like 6 months ago.
A little bit. So what you guys can't see is in the studio from time to time, when we have guests, we also have visitors that come in and sit down with us and watch episodes. And Danny is one of those people who's been a long supporter and has come in and has sat on a couple of episodes.
Yeah.
And an avid watch collector. A young watch collector,
yeah.
Which I think makes this really, really interesting. But he has really great taste in watches. And we're going to share some of that with you tonight. But before we continue, we've got to have our honorary wrist check. Ben, you want to kick us off?
Yeah, so I actually forgot we were filming today.
Okay.
But I got a new watch.
Uh-oh.
And I forgot to bring it.
Okay.
So we'll talk about it in the next episode. But I went with the Vacheron today, the 56.
Not a bad one to go
I'm
with.
I'm wearing a Hawaiian shirt and shorts. I'm going to wear something elevated on my wrist.
Ooh,
that's just all there is.
Get them.
So that was my thought process today.
Respect.
Cool.
Danny, what do you got for us, man?
So I have a black Aquanaut.
Let's go.
This is my like everyday wear.
Perfect sports
say,
watch.
Say what it really is. Say it's a beater.
Not a beater. It's something I enjoy wearing every day. I like how low key it is and that it doesn't get too much attention, but you know, it's really accurate. So I really love that. I'm really particular about accuracy in my watches. But yeah, it's pretty much.
The beauty about that piece too, is that you can literally, so the reason why he calls it a beater is, and I get why you don't, you will. One day, very soon.
I wore one for a year.
Yeah.
I know what it's like.
But the fact is, to his point, you can wear it for a year. It goes with everything.
Yes.
The case proportions on the Aquanaut are impeccable.
Mm-hmm.
It's just thin enough. It's just wide enough. The dial is just pretty enough. And the rubber strap is comfortable and just stylish enough.
Yeah, I think the rubber strap is my favorite. I love rubber straps.
Beautiful. And I think to Ben's point, and just knowing him and his love for this as like one of the most perfect sports watches.
I called it that on one of the episodes.
He did. Yeah. Is when you talk about like where we come from and what we love, like, because we're New Yorkers, born and raised, right? Yeah. And love sneakers, streetwear, the culture. There's something about Aquanaut because it's so beautiful and it's so elevated, but it's also still very street.
Yeah.
And I don't mean that in a pedestrian way. I mean that in a, like, sort of like how you're rocking with it. Like when you think about it and you're considering like you, white t-shirt, windbreakers, New Balances, Aquanaut, fire.
Yeah. You don't necessarily think that when you think Patek.
You don't.
But,
yeah. But it works perfect.
That's why they made that.
That's why they made it.
It's perfect.
Yeah. It's perfect. A 90s baby. Perfect.
It is. Yeah, yeah, no. Yeah. No, for definitely. Sure.
And definitely. Danny got a good one too.
He it's has
the,
a great one.
It's the 5165. So it's the smaller version of what's in the current collection, the 5167.
It is.
The perfect. So it's even better proportions.
It's incredible. Yeah. Moving along. My man Rafa's got a very special watch.
I was going to say, I'm channeling Rashawn, so it's a very, very, very special
watch. Very special.
That's a new watch for you.
It's a new watch. So, I haven't worn it on the show.
Yeah. So if you don't remember, I think it was the end of season 3. We had Rafa and his wife on, Nacho. And they were one of my favorite episodes, by the way, Love and Watches. Where Rashawn got it super poetic.
Oh, my God.
But it was a lot of fun. And this was a watch that we talked about that season because Watches and Wonders had just transpired and we're big Tudor fans.
Yep.
But you picked up the...
Yeah, the Tudor Black Bay Pro.
On bracelet.
On the bracelet.
It's fire.
I got it yesterday. It's an awesome watch. Very comfortable. Love the look. It's not too thick. Yes, all the haters out there, it's not
too thick.
See, like Ben, obviously Ben was going to complain
too
about
thick.
It.
Now, to be fair, everybody on this couch... We like them thick.
Hey.
But that watch don't do it.
It's great, man. It's pretty awesome.
So let me say this about this piece. I tried this on a NATO, on the NATO that, Tudor makes. And I wasn't feeling it. But we were sharing this one with everyone behind the scenes before we got started. And on the bracelet, when you wear it, it actually wears nicely.
Yeah.
It is a thick watch. I'm not going to lie. But it doesn't wear thick on your wrist. It doesn't feel crazy.
Not with the bracelet on.
No, it's 39. It's 39. It just fits. I think it's great. And I like a hefty watch. I don't like titanium ultra like light watches. I like a watch that I can feel
it. You want to feel some substance.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I like about that piece is that it and what I love about Tudor is they are today, and we say this all the time, what Rolex used to be.
Yep.
And this feels like a tool watch.
Exactly.
It feels nice.
I'm going to scratch it up. I'm going to travel with it. You're not gonna be scared to wear it.
Purpose that thing and make it yours. That thing is beautiful, man. And I'm a little envious. I gotta admit.
You'll get one. I can feel it.
We'll see. Oh man!
Shout out to Barry's wife. Please let
shout
him
out
get
to
one.
My wife. Yes, let me have.
You got
one.
An anniversary. It might happen.
Yeah, wedding anniversary is coming up. Yeah. So who knows? I too am wearing a Tudor this evening. I'm wearing my handy dandy and trusty. Bronze Black Bay 58 on the bracelet. Nice. And I love this thing. I've had this for almost a year now. Yeah. I got this late August last year. Mm-hmm.
You got it right away.
I did.
When it came out.
Yeah. I did. Yeah. And I shared that story too on the podcast. Shout out to Nick Milo for the layup and the assist.
Facts.
Big facts. Who helped me get this because he had the relationship. And I love this piece. I've gotten to the point where I've assembled quite a few watches. just a little bit. I do feel a little guilty from time to time, but what's nice is when I do break a piece out that I haven't worn in a while. And I used to wear this a lot.
Yeah, you did.
And I haven't worn it in some time.
I feel like because it got hot out, you stopped wearing it.
Yeah. And but wearing it now, I'm just falling in love with it all over again. And it's really nice to look at. Feels great on the wrist.
Has a lot of patina already.
Has got a ton of patina.
You can clean it up?
I think so. So I was looking at videos earlier today on how to go about cleaning this one. And I know how to clean the bronze watch, but this one is, this one's a little different because it has aluminum content to it. So the interesting thing with the Tudor Bronze Black Bay, it doesn't develop any of that green rust. It doesn't get any of it. And it's because of the alloy content. So it's just all patina. And I was looking at some videos. I think I'm going to clean it up because I remember when I first got this, it looked almost rose gold. It was nice.
We were looking at photos of it together today.
We were. And it did. And it was very nice. And not that I'm upset about how it looks now. I love it. But I would like to see that and experience it again. So I think I'm going to go. I'm going to figure it out.
Get some summer patina on there.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I clean it up, take it to the beach, purpose it all over again. So that's that. Moving along to our guest, our special guest of the season.
Very special guest.
Don't guess Danny. It really is a pleasure to have you here because we spent a great deal of time getting to know one another and talking. And I remember when I first met you. And
I was picking up a tutor.
You were
two
you were tutors. Picking up two tutors.
Yes.
And we really got to talking about watches and sneakers and just the culture. And I really enjoyed that conversation. But before we get into that, I just want to explore a little bit of your origin story. So you're a native New Yorker.
Yes, I'm from Jamaica, Queens.
Jamaica, Queens. Shout out to Jamaica, Queens.
You took the words out of my mouth. I'm
going to say shout out to Queens get the money.
Queens get the money. Respect. But who is Danny? Where is he? We know you're from Queens.
Okay.
What's your story? How do you know? What's your New York story?
All right. So I grew up in Jamaica, Queens on 150th and Hillside, basically on right next to Kings Park.
Mm.
If anybody's familiar with that area, two blocks away from Jamaica Ave. My parents are both Colombian. My entire family's Colombian. They came here in the 70s. They had me. I'm a 90s baby. We lived our whole life there. My parents still live there. My aunts still live there. They all live across the street from one another. Everyone is, I mean, we love Queens. It's just where, you know, we basically, you know, they immigrated from here. They came here to have a better, you know, have a better future for us than what they were experiencing in their homeland. And I just try to strive to make them proud. And, you know, I really, really don't take for granted the sacrifices they made. And the jobs they took on so that I could be in the position I'm in right now.
That's awesome.
As a owner of District 1 and a real estate investor as well.
There we go.
Yeah.
Respect.
Yeah.
So knowing your story, so Queens is a special place for those that aren't that familiar with
most diverse borough in the world.
It really is.
Place in the world.
I lived in Queens for a little bit while I was in college. I lived on, I was on Ditmars. And like, I think 79th, I was right behind the airport.
Okay.
And the most diverse borough I experienced. Quite literally. And the thing with Queens is, because there are different boroughs in New York, obviously, that and different areas in these boroughs that have diversity. Queens has always been consistent, right? I remember when I lived out there, you had the Greek community, the Jewish community, Arab community, heavy Indian community.
Facts.
If you want Indian food in New York, Queens, you can't go wrong.
Place.
Especially like Queens, you can't go wrong with Indian, Italian, and Greek food. You're going to get some of the best, right? Yeah. Huge melting pot and very underrated in terms of what the borough has to offer in food. You don't know unless you visit.
For sure.
Hands down.
I mean, just to give you an idea, my best friend, his name is Bala, he's African.
Okay.
My next door neighbor was Indian.
Yeah.
Person right in front of me was Chinese.
Yep.
And then the rest of the building was mostly Dominicans, Puerto Ricans.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, we had such a broad scope that I got to understand and I was able to communicate with so many people from different places.
Right.
And kind of understand how, you know, Muslims pray at a certain time.
Yep.
Indian people pray at a certain time, how, you know, certain times you can't, I just understood more of their culture. Like, mm-hmm. I understand when my family's Catholic. When mm-hmm. there was, you know, Easter was out. It was just so many different things I was experiencing, where it's kind of confusing, right? Because you're sure. like, who's right? Right?
Yeah. And all
this stuff.
Yeah.
But you're just like, you learn how to communicate with everyone, which I think helps me now
as 100%.
With all the people that I get to meet every single day, just to be able to communicate with them and kind of find something in common with them.
Yeah.
Which a lot of people, when you don't grow up in these kind of things, it's difficult for you to communicate. Maybe you don't speak, you know, mm-hmm. English properly or things like that. But it's so easy for me because just I'm used to it. That's my whole childhood.
That's the beauty about New York is growing up with that sort of expanse of like diversity, you know, where you're gonna foster relationships with people from varied backgrounds,
yes.
right? And you'll find those commonalities. And I think one of those commonalities, just knowing your story, was sneakers.
Yes.
Right. And if you know anything about New York, New York has a heavy sneaker culture via hip hop,
yeah.
pop culture, design, fashion, etc. And you dove in head first, from what I understand.
So yeah.
you were one of the few, maybe one of the many young people in New York
yeah.
during the heyday when streetwear started to really rise and pop and bubble.
That's when Instagram started popping too.
Yeah.
So it was like 2012, 2011.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I was in college and I still remember just one of my friends was telling me I needed some money, right? Because mm-hmm. I was a college baseball player and my dream was to make it to the MLB. That was my only, nothing mattered but making it there.
Right.
And in the process of that, you know, you're a starving college athlete.
Sure.
You're hungry. Like, you're literally hungry.
Yeah.
And at that time, I remember one of my friends saying, like, hey, if you're looking for some side money, these military foam posits, I think they're called, like, the Army Camo ones, were releasing. So he was like, come with me to Jimmy Jazz. Like, I guarantee you we're going to make some money. Okay. So we went. Mm. This was like 2012 or 11. I don't remember the exact year, but
okay.
we went. I took my $400 I had saved.
Mm-hmm.
I took my best friend Ballas, $250 he had saved. I went. I bought three pairs, lost $50 on each one. I still don't forget. And I was like, damn. Like, why did I lose?
You said you was gonna make money.
It's like, man, I lost $150. What's going on, man? But
when you only have $400,
yeah,
you lose $150. You know, you feel like you're going, you're broke. You're back to zero again.
And you lost money on a friend's.
And I lost money from my friend.
Yeah.
So he got turned off right away. So
sure.
the next time I was like, yo, there's another opportunity.
Yeah.
He was like, hell no. Like, you're just going to lose money.
Yeah.
But little by little, I started understanding. I started doing more research on eBay.
Mm.
At that time, I also had a job at American Girl.
Weah. Okay. I didn't know
that. Did not expect that.
Yeah. Wow.
So I worked as a cashier.
Respect.
Yeah. And one thing we started doing was this is how I got into reselling, period.
Mm.
I remember the holiday season, they had a doll called McKenna. And so those dolls were sold out.
Yes.
And when those dolls would be returned, because, you know, a lot of people, nobody's really reselling dolls, right? But a lot of people would return them because their daughter didn't want them, whatever. It's the holidays. So I started noticing that those dolls were going for like $300 on eBay
because
everybody wanted them
right.
for Christmas.
Exactly.
So I was getting them for $80, right? So right away, it clicked. I'm like, wait.
Like,
I was telling
ka-ching! Them
on the
man started
flipping the market. So I told my wife, well, my girlfriend at the time, we've been with 14 years now.
Respect. Shout out to her.
Yep, for sure. Christy, love you.
Shout out to Christy.
Shout out to Christy.
And I told her, hey, let's open up an eBay account under your name so I don't get fired.
Respect.
You know, you sell under your... So we did just that. And every doll that got returned, I would ask an employee to do me a favor and get it for me because I'll give it to a niece, whatever. Plus, nobody really knew. So they didn't care.
Sure, they didn't really get
so,
it.
So yeah, we're just flipping those dolls. And as time went on, you know, I made some pretty good money. I was making, I remember like my check was $300 a week and then I was making like $400 a week on the dolls.
Wow.
So I was like, okay, right? There's a disconnect.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, they're telling us to look out for these resellers
because
mm-hmm. they didn't like them at right. American Girl.
Under their nose.
Not realizing, that, you know, I was like, wait, these resellers are kind of smart because they're coming in here buying these dolls and making this easy money. And then as I got, you know, I started understanding more of the resale. I got more familiar with eBay. And then my later on, I ended up getting fired from American Girl because I was going to sneaker releases and coming in late. Right? And I was devastated. Like, yeah. I loved that job. I was making a lot of money on the side. I was having a good time.
Well, how old were you at this time?
I was like 19.
$300 a week, 19.
I was making, I still remember to this day, $10.50 an hour. I was happy.
Yeah.
I was a
competitor. Back then, at that age,
I was happy.
That's good money.
A lot of these people making 15 now, you should be happy.
Yo, when I was 18, my job was paying me $9.50 an hour.
Well, same. $10.50 was lit. I was happy.
My first job was at a hand car wash.
Yeah, I would have. Yeah.
Yeah, no.
I mean, I got my first job under the books, so it don't even count. I was on the bread truck.
I was getting off the books too.
I was getting cash every Friday.
I was getting cash. Yeah.
So before that, in 2010, I did construction in the summer with my dad.
Right.
And I remember I was getting $15 an hour. And so it was cash. It was great. And but I started realizing, I'm like, this is a lot of work. Like, construction is no joke.
No joke.
And I started telling my dad, I was like, you know, I really started appreciating him then more.
Because you got to see what he was going through.
Because I was like, dude, you're lifting up these cement pallets.
For the family.
15, and my dad was getting paid the same as me.
Crazy.
So I was like, holy crap, I want to make sure, like, I don't ever forget this. But I also told him, I'm never going to do construction again after the summer.
Facts.
I knew it. I was like, I'm not working with my hands.
Yeah.
I know it sounds, you know, less manly than most people. I'm terrible with my hands. I'm perfectly fine not working with my hands. I prefer to work with my mind.
Respect.
So I remember telling him, like, yo, I'm done with this. Like, I'm never doing this. So at that time, I remember my boss, his name was Ronnie. And I remember him swiping up on his phone and saying he just made $75,000.
Wow.
Meanwhile, I'm getting $120 a day.
Yeah.
Right. So I'm like, all right, wait. $120 a day, homie just made $75,000.
Of a swipe. Swiping.
I didn't understand what he was doing, but he was just selling some stocks he bought.
Yeah.
Like, he was a stock trader and he was a construction. He was a contractor. So I was like, wait. So if this dude just made $75,000, I'm working here with my dad for $120 a day. How much is he making on this deal?
Yeah.
Right, comes to find out, he was making like $10,000 on like 4 days of work. Wow. And me and my dad were getting $400 each, right? And I was like, all right. I knew right then something clicked. And I was like, okay, I got to understand how money works. Because if he's swiping up saying he makes $75,000 and I'm here making $120 a day, it's not my dad's fault because he came from another country. He had no idea. But I was like, I'm going to do better because there's no way I'm going to do this in my future.
Right.
I knew off rip. Right then and there, I knew I was going to be successful because I knew I was never going to do that again because the thing he clicked in me that day, I never forgot it. To this day, that's the story that I knew that day I was done at least working construction. And I knew, I was like, okay, I got to understand economics and money so that I'm never working like this for this salary again.
Right.
Right. And that moment really clicked for me. And then as for reselling, American Girl fired me. I was devastated. And I remember my girlfriend at the time, my wife now, told me, what are you worried about? Like, you're already making more money on these lines than you are at work.
Shout out to her.
For sure. And then I remember she absolutely believed in me. And then I started doing it in college. And then my senior year of college, I had an injury playing baseball. So I was like, you know what? I'm just going to dedicate my entire time to just reselling shoes because I felt like at that time, Kifa just came up and they were releasing, I remember, Mercer pants every Monday.
Yes.
And I was going every Monday right before class and I was coming to class with like six of these pants and and posting them in the class, in class on eBay, selling them while in class, then shipping them as soon as I was leaving class to the customer. So right away, all my teachers were like, dude, what are you doing? Why are you coming with these? Why are you shopping every day?
Yeah.
That was their favorite phrase. And I was like, I'm not shopping. I'm
making money.
I'm making money. Yeah. But a lot of people look down at reselling at that time.
They still do.
Yeah.
They still do.
But it's still, I think it's more glorified now as more resellers have gotten more successful, especially through, a lot of people kind of look up to us now, right? The ones that are doing really well because they're like, oh, that's an awesome career. Yeah. You live on your own terms. Blah, blah, blah.
I feel like if you're removed from it, you do.
Yeah.
But if you're in it, it's just a grind. If you see them,
they still kind of look down on them.
For sure. And I'm cool with that. And I still remember a lot of people were like, yo, go get a job. Da, 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 da. And I was always like, tunnel vision. Like, I knew my numbers. I was making like $400 a day in college every day. So I was like, I don't care what anybody's saying. This is better than the 120 much easier than the 120 I was making three right. years back.
Yes.
So I was like, there's no way I'm going to go back to that life. So everybody right. telling me, go get a job, da da da. I was like, whatever. You're Who cares? I'll probably make it more than you right now.
Yeah.
So when I ended up going to college, my senior year, I had 3 credits left. I had to graduate. And at that time, I remember I had made like $50,000 for the year. And I was like, do I really want to go back to college? Because that was a lot of money. For sure. me, that was, everybody was telling me I was going to go get a job. To and you go talk, ask but for $60,000.
Yeah. You know, you talk about you made $50,000 cash.
Exactly. Well, it wasn't cash. I was selling it on eBay. It had to be reported.
Okay.
Right. And to be clear, I didn't see any money for the first 7 years that I resold.
Wow.
I just stacked all my money. I didn't spend a dollar. Wow. Because I was so focused that I understood as I got older that the more money I had, the more money it would make me.
Yes. Right?
So a lot of people want to spend it the moment that they touch it, not understanding that $100,000 is nothing.
Yeah.
Right? It's nothing.
You're not seeing the big picture. Nothing. At that point.
Not understanding that if you have $10 million in the bank, you're guaranteed to make $1 million a year.
Yeah.
Doing nothing.
So you're jumping ahead.
Yeah.
Because I am, now you
for sure. But I just
now you're letting yeah. people know.
No, for sure. I realized that early.
But though, I understand
to
that.
To not and touch
I,
my
and,
money.
And that's key because I think one of the things for me that makes this so special is understanding your roots and where you come yeah. from and how you literally flipped your way to the top.
Yeah. But I wanted to stress that point about the money just because a lot of people in our culture, we're taught to spend, yes. right? And I think we need to be educated. Like, I'm here today and I'm grateful to have these watches to show right. you guys later. But understand that I didn't spend money for 7 years.
Yeah.
Right? So I think we just need to spread it in our culture, especially to Latinos and African-Americans, especially us. Like, you have to invest your money
yes.
and not spend it as soon as you touch it.
That's the only reason I mentioned that. Spend it before you even get it. That's
everybody I know that I grew up with spends it even now. As soon as they touch it, and I'm like, dude, you have no idea that every dollar you spend now is potentially 10 that you have down the road. And I think that's the only reason I stress that, because I think, you know,
I love that.
You have to understand as you're coming up, invest your money, whether it be in stocks, whether it's in yourself, whether it's in product
yes.
that you're flipping.
But invest it.
Just invest it, man. Just don't
invest it in a way that will produce you more money.
That's it. Like,
100%.
That's literally the key.
That's
all. But
that's the key.
But besides that, I started reselling 2016. I remember I hired my wife. She hated her job. she worked for a company called Baby Center.
And, okay.
She worked for my cousin.
Right.
Just to preview that job, I had a chance at getting. But at the time, I was doing okay. So I told my wife, hey, you're graduating college. I remember it was like $27 an hour. Amazing job out of college. Mm. Amazing. And I was like, why don't you take it? She took it. A year later, hated it.
Mm.
That 9 to 5, but it was like a slave shift, right? So she started getting, the amount of work she was being put on as an intern.
Right.
Right? Was a lot for her. And I started growing, and then I started getting overwhelmed because I could no longer respond to customer ship orders, try to go buy product in the same day.
Right.
It was just taking up so much time for me.
Yeah.
So then at that time, she wasn't happy. I asked her if she would like to quit her job to join me, which, by the way, was insane. I wasn't making that much, but it was something that I was just like, you know what? If you're not happy and I'm overwhelmed, and I'm not happy right now.
Help me not be overwhelmed.
Help me, right? And she quit. And
wow.
It just goes to show, like, she believed, right?
She did.
To quit that job, to just be like, you know what? I'm going to bet that you're going to put in that work in the streets.
100%.
Because, by the way, I was lining up every day
yeah.
to go get shoes. So she believed in me to go get these shoes, and then she would be doing the back end work. So,
that's incredible.
Yeah. So that, and then she ended up quitting her job. 2019, I partnered with my partner, who now we own half of District One each, and his name is Simon. We were our main competitors.
Shout out to Simon.
For sure. We were our main competitors. And that year, I remember telling him, like, dude, like, we're killing each other out here. You know, outbidding each other, and mainly me. Because I was competitive, dude. I don't want to lose, you know? So we realized, like, okay. Took some convincing from him. But I explained to him, I'm really good at kind of realizing early on when somebody could potentially work with me, and if we both can add value to one another's life.
Right.
And we were both killing ourselves. So I was like, dude, if we just join together with my wife, I think we could build something really special.
Optimus Prime.
For sure. And then 2021 in April, was it April or May? I forgot. We opened District One. And you know, we're very blessed. That's my journey. Just understanding when to partner with people, just like my wife, just like Simon, when the time is right. And when you're just, when you realize you've reached a cap with the skills you have. Mm-hmm. I know I'm not the smartest person. You know, I had a 2.9 GPA, C average in high school, and still didn't finish my degree. I'm still missing some credits. But I knew I wasn't the smartest, but I knew that I could get with people that were smarter than me, and they would be able to add to what I can do, right? So I think knowing where your intelligence, where it kind of peaks, and then understanding that other people can add to your repertoire, and then they'll help you scale.
Right.
And that's my story.
That's incredible.
Yeah.
That's incredible. I think in terms of your story, you know, you guys talking about you partnering with Simon and building this business. It's incredible because when you think about pop culture, when you think about streetwear, sneaker culture, you know, we didn't really foresee this.
No.
10, 12, 15 years ago.
No.
You know what I'm saying? So the fact that someone could quite literally get online, buy sneakers, sell them for profit, and do that over and over and over again.
Same.
To partner with someone, to build a business. I don't want to say how much your business is worth, but
no, for sure.
To the point to where you have an Aquanaut on your wrist.
Yeah.
At 30 years old.
Yeah.
Is incredible.
Thank you for that.
And you have a lot to be proud of. And just knowing you and your story and what you do today, you give back to the community. Yes. You know, so for people who don't understand, District One is it's a sneaker shop, right? Buy, sell, trade.
Yeah.
But not only do you buy, sell, trade, you also actually, you give product away for free. You donate product to the community a lot.
Yeah.
And I think that's why you guys are so beloved. And I think it's important for us and our platform to give you your flowers, because it's not every day that someone comes from our background, you know, that shares our story, that understands what it's like to come from where we come from as New Yorkers, that actually gives back to New Yorkers.
For sure.
And you do that often with a lot of the initiatives that you do outside of your shop, where people can come and, you know, before school starts, get sneakers for their kids.
Yeah.
Get sneakers for their wives, get sneakers for their husbands, get footwear for, you know, their family who's going to school, starting a new job. And you do all of these things. So I commend you, because it is incredibly admirable.
I appreciate that.
And you deserve the flowers for that.
Thank you.
So what I want to get into next.
Let me just say one thing.
Please.
Sorry. The one thing I wanted to do with District One was make sneakers accessible to everyone.
Yes.
Right? I think sometimes a lot of these stores, like the higher end ones, Flight Club, the Stadium Goods.
Uh-huh.
You walk in there and, you know, if you're, especially from lower class, you can't literally buy a shoe.
You cannot.
Yeah.
It's the cheapest shoes are like $250 and they suck, the ones that are $250. So what I wanted people to do when we did District One was create something where, yo, you could buy a Flint 13 for $100. You could buy a Black Cement 3 for $140. You can, like, there's things that you can buy in my store that you will not find in the country for those prices,
And for the people who are uninitiated, a Flint 13, a Black Cement 3 probably should sell for $300 to $400
100%
I take pride in that, just to have Jordans out for $75.
As you should.
You know, like, we're not greedy. We buy things for cheap, yes, when it's right, right? When you shoes. But we price them equally out for cheap. We don't want to make the most. All we're interested in is selling a lot of shoes, but making it where we are bringing in the community and people that look like us to be able to walk into our store and be able to buy something that they looked at on the screen and were always like, I'm never going to buy that.
Yeah.
Right.
I think that's what's one of the things that's most incredible about your business is that you've focused on moving volume in such a way that it creates an atmosphere and environment that's equitable.
Yeah.
Right? And so it's like, you know, maybe you can't spend that much, but we will create situations and scenarios that you can participate. Mm-hmm. And for sure. Sometimes you get stuff for dirt cheap. Other times you get stuff for free.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? We're here for you.
The system that Danny and Simon built too, they're the only sneaker store that does buy, sell, trade.
That's it.
Period.
Yep.
You can come in with a pair of shoes that might be worth less than what you pay retail, but you can trade them up and add some cash and get something. You could trade a bunch of stuff and get something that's really expensive and really hot right now, and you can make it work for yourself.
And so what you're doing not only influences the culture and promotes the culture, but it makes it accessible for people who have humble beginnings like you came from.
For sure.
That I think is really awesome. And people, most people who we've come across, and we've come across a lot of people in your shoes, forget that.
Yep.
You and Simon have not forgotten that.
No, for sure.
And so respect.
And you win like that too. Because yeah. people,
you do
people,
win like that.
You win, because you win the people.
Because you know people what happens? Love us, you know what happens? That. Is that people who do have the discretionary income say, I'm with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm with you. For I'm sure. going to spend my money with you because of what you do.
And we also have shoes that go up to $100,000.
100%.
So we have both, right?
You cater to everybody.
We have for the ballers, and then we have for maybe you only got $30.
100%.
And we might have something that day for you.
Anytime you can walk into the sneaker store and beat somebody in rock, paper, scissors and get a free pair of shoes,
we do that all the time.
That's a place you should go. That's crazy.
That's a place you should go.
All the time.
So, moving along.
Yeah.
Danny today is a watch collector.
Yes.
How did this happen?
Collector. All right.
Where did this start?
It all started with all the grandchildren.
Where did this start?
So every day I went to work, I saw my partner Simon wearing a white Daytona.
Shout out to Simon.
Yeah. I didn't know that much about watches.
Okay.
I'm only a year and change into this hobby.
So this is a big flex, yeah. just so you understand, because
when we get through the collection, people are going to be
when
like,
we get
how
through
the
collection, Danny, and you talk about I'm only a year in.
Yeah. I don't want to lie. It's a year.
I respect it, but Danny, people are going to be like, son is wild. All
right.
Nah, they're not going to say he's wilding. They're going to be fucking jealous.
Well, both.
So I basically saw him wearing a white Daytona every day.
Okay.
And I was like, dude, why do you wear this watch every single day?
Yeah.
I didn't care about watches or anything. And he was like, dude, this watch is a part of me. And I was like, I don't know what you mean it's a part of you. Like, why do you wear it? And he's just like, it's just a part of my uniform.
Yeah.
Just the same way I got to put on, I got to do, you know, brush my hair, I got to whatever. I got to wear this watch. Like, I just can't take it off. And I didn't understand.
Yeah.
But then, you know, when we opened District 1, I wanted to celebrate our opening. It was an accomplishment that I dreamed of for a long time. And, you know, I didn't know if it was going to work or not. Like, we had just opened the doors, but I was like, it's time to buy something nice for yourself. It's
absolutely.
Been 7 years. You never spent.
Never spent anything. You're going to get yourself something nice.
Exactly.
What'd you get?
So the first one I got was Grand Seiko White Snowflake, which I don't have here right now.
Okay.
I got it in the house. But I remember I went to Grand Seiko. I went to Watch of Switzerland and Grand Seiko.
Yeah.
And at Grand Seiko, I met somebody named Chris.
Okay.
Basically explained the importance of spring drive. And I'm not a genius when it comes to these movements and things like that. But he explained to me spring drive and I was just fascinated.
Sure.
Right? How accurate.
Right.
Right? I'm big on accuracy. I really like accuracy. And how that watch was more accurate than watches that cost $100,000.
Yeah.
Right? And I was like blown away.
Right.
So I was like, that has to be my first watch.
Mm.
And again, he did a great job of selling it. And then I did, you know, YouTube gets you when you start looking
up. Oh, yes, it does.
You know, you look at something on the shelf, you go on YouTube, and you're like, holy crap, this is a dope-ass watch. And man, did I not know the can of worms that was going to open once I bought it. I think that like the next week, I asked him for the Shunbun,
Shunbun.
The pink one. And I was dude, I want... Yep.
So you got two watches in the same week?
No, it was like 3 weeks.
So the same month.
They were on
same month. You got two watches.
Same month you got two watches. From zero to two.
But Grand Seiko has my heart just because of.
And so this was a year ago.
Yeah. This was in March last year.
So this accelerated very quickly.
Yeah. This is
wow. Okay, let's get into it. So, because now things are getting very interesting. I didn't know this.
Yeah. So I got the Grand Seiko from Chris. And then I remember Simon was like, yo, if you could like get on the list to get me a Rolex. And at the time I was like, yeah, cool, whatever. Like, so I remember I signed up for the Kermit and they called me like the next week. Yo, we got a Kermit for you. And then
I remember
Simon going, right. I was like, Simon, I'm gonna go get this watch for you, you know, because he wanted to wear it.
Right.
But then he was like, dude, I need you to first put it on. I'm gonna feel guilty if I take it from you, because it's worth more money. You know, it's a money thing too.
Because Simon would feel like he was getting one over on you.
Exactly. And he was like, I really want you to put it on.
Make sure you want it.
Make sure you don't want it.
Right.
Then give it to me.
Right.
That was a mistake.
Because he wanted it.
Because he kept it.
I put it on and I was like, oh, snap.
Simon, I want this.
Simon, I'm sorry. This is a really dope watch. He was really happy for me. He's like,
that's
bro,
awesome.
Enjoy your Rolex. I wanted you to try it on. Boy, then from there, it was just, you know, I didn't know about Rolex. I didn't know about, you know, Patek. I didn't know. And then I kept getting Grand Seikos because I remember I got the white birch. Again, it was the next step after the snowflake. And I was just like, I love this watch. But it was not as accurate as advertised.
Yo, Danny has a beef with the white birch.
Yeah.
Really?
Every time he wears that watch, he's like,
I got it serviced and it's still like 15, 20 seconds off a day.
Ooh. He's like, yo, this is not as accurate as my other Grand Seikos. Yeah. He's like, I can't.
And like
wear
I said, I care about accuracy with my watches. Right?
That's like, I care.
And a lot of these watches here are pretty good with accuracy. But I started and then I went to watch in Switzerland and learned more about Rolex, Patek, and you know, ever since then you guys will see some of the pieces I've gotten. But I'm not gonna say the number of watches, but you know, I have a pretty good amount of watches.
Well, I wanna know, how many watches do you own now?
Is it one for every day of the month?
No.
Close?
Yeah. Like 22, 24.
That's a lot of watches. You competed with Rashawn.
Oh, yeah, I was going to say all the Rashawn.
Yeah, but I will say, you know, I probably will slim down soon because I think it's okay for people to understand that your taste evolves.
Yeah.
Right?
100%.
So I started with a Grand Seiko and I'm obviously wearing a more hyped up watch right now. But I will say that my heart is still with Grand Seiko. Like, I love the brand. But my taste has changed, right? Yeah. So I don't necessarily need all the watches when I first started learning, because I'm impulsive, right? And I know myself, but I'm impulsive in business too. And I think that's actually something that's helped me, because I'm always on tunnel vision. And I still try to make smart financial decisions, obviously.
I think that's the key too with you too, just from knowing you and speaking to you, is that you programmed yourself not to make purchases unless you know that in dire straits, it can earn you more money.
Yes, I mean, at the end of the day, when you're spending this kind of money that I'm spending on watches, it financially, you do care if you're losing money. Right? I don't think it's, I know a lot of watch collectors are gonna say, no, it's about the watch, and it is, but at the same time.
But you're making smart investments.
You don't wanna just, you know, burn a hole of, you know,
for no
a ton
reason.
Of money.
Precisely because your taste evolves too, what you said. And like maybe you want to move some pieces, not because you don't like them or because you want to flip them or make money, but because like you just change your style.
You learn about the brand.
Like, you enjoyed it for a couple months, a year, whatever, and then you move on, you sell it, you get something else.
Right? Yeah.
So in terms of what we have with us today.
We have a special Grand Seiko with us today.
What's the oldest piece here?
The oldest piece here is the Roberto Clemente. That's the first, that's like
Let's
the third
that.
Watch I got.
Let's pick that one up. Let's share that. So what was it about? So this is a brand that's very near and dear to us. We have ties to this brand.
I have three Orises.
Through respect. I love them. We have ties to this brand through the people. We love the culture of this brand. We love the people whom we know who work for this brand, who are responsible for growing this brand. And we really, really have an affection for Oris. But what about the Roberto Clemente did it for you that was like, this belongs in my collection?
Baseball.
Respect. Okay, so
period.
Going to that.
One of the greatest ever.
Yes.
Right? One of the first Latinos.
Let's go.
Special to me. I obviously never saw him play, but I damn sure I was told about
him. You know about
his
him.
Definitely.
100%.
I know more about him than I know of Babe Ruth. right?
Amen.
So as soon as I saw it, I had just gotten the Snowflake.
Yeah.
And I was getting into watches, and I saw that this popped up on YouTube. And I was like, well, that's a cool Roberto Clemente inspired watch, right? And I love the tan on the straps because it reminds me of the glove I had.
Yeah. So the beautiful thing about this piece is that the strap patinas very quickly.
Amazing.
You've seen mine.
Awesome. It's very dark brown.
It looks good, man.
It just reminds me of a vintage baseball glove.
Yeah.
And it's nice.
That story of, you know, them collaborating to commemorate him, somebody who was an amazing baseball player, but even more important, a person, a kind of person I would like to be, you know, as I get more successful. It's just amazing. And I bought it right away. I got it on eBay, I remember. I got it for like 25% off or something like that.
Shout out to VJ. Shout out to Rolf.
Yeah. Shout out to Oris as a whole.
And that's actually, I don't care the price, but that's one of my most important pieces. And I actually wear that all the time. And I'll never sell that piece for sure.
So what's for me, what's really great about this is, so I'm in Jersey City. And where I live, there's a baseball park where a lot of teams play. There's a lot of like girls softball teams. The name of the park is Roberto Clemente Field.
Fire.
Nice.
In Jersey City. So this has that for me, and this is dope. I love this watch, and
I love it.
I'm upset that I actually don't own one, but I will borrow Ben's at some point.
Yeah, that's fine.
It's in the family. But this is a great piece, man. This is a really great piece. Oris is a really great brand. And I think in terms of knowing what you own in your collection, which we'll get more into, but like obviously you showed up tonight wearing an Aquanaut and you own an Oris, I think speaks volumes.
Yeah, it's okay to have, you know, you don't need everything expensive. I think the beauty about it, about watches, right?
But in terms of like
scope.
Absolutely. Scope. So you have taste. And I think that's the key, right? Because when I think about Oris, especially this piece, the Roberto Clemente, which is a pointer date, Oris does these watches really, really well. This coin bezel edge that they do is beautiful.
It's so easy to see the time.
I mean, just in terms of details.
The room on that watch is also bright as fuck.
It's incredible. And I think it speaks volumes about you as a collector to own Oris. I'm always impressed by people who are impressed by Oris because Oris is a fire watch
brand.
Well,
just what they do for the community, right? Like the New York Harbor, I got the Harbor. But that's amazing.
You picked up the New York Harbor.
Yes.
Shout out to VJ. He's going to love hearing that. Yeah. But you picked up the New York Harbor, which is a watch that we participated in the launch with.
Yep.
In terms of like events
and the whole activation was a good time.
It was I had a ball.
But the story, right? The story gets me. It's like
it's a New York story. New York.
Yeah. Why would
it's
I?
It's a New York story.
It's an amazing watch.
Why would I? Well, the two of you have it.
We have Rafa, the back-to-back numbers.
We got two guys that got the New York Harbor watch.
They picked it up at the same time.
Yeah. BJ, oh, yes.
We got it the same day.
Rolf.
I have to give a shout out to my wife.
We need one for the car.
Yeah, shout out to Nacha.
It's actually her watch, but yes, it's but a mother it's, but we share
pearl.
It.
It's a green mother of pearls.
Yeah, she's a queen of mother of pearls, so she really wanted that mother
I think
pearl.
We should collectively get one for the pod.
We should.
Yeah. Yeah.
We'll figure it out. I'll hit VJ tomorrow.
I need a certain number, though. I need my birth year. If you listen, then VJ.
Good luck. We got back-to-back numbers.
Yeah.
I wanted my birth year.
Yeah, I know. but this is a beautiful watch, man. And
shout out Oris sponsor.
Shout out to Oris, man. I think in terms of, but I think that, you know, that I think that's something that also resonates with your story, right? Is because when you are a collector who collects footwear or et cetera, you have to have the foresight to look at something and say, that's special.
Yeah, sure.
And you had that with this. And I think that speaks volumes about your taste in timepieces. So there's something there that exists within you already in terms of what you are able to kind of sort out and pick and say, like, this is special and this is meaningful to my collection or to my business, and translate that to other hobbies and pastimes, one such as collecting timepieces. So shout out to you.
Thank you.
Yeah, this is a special piece.
I want to talk about the Grand Seiko next.
So now this watch this is a good one. So this is a limited edition piece that they did, right?
I don't know if it has a name, but it's SBGH269.
That's the name.
Wow, okay.
He knows the reference.
I know that of this one, yeah.
So when I first met you, you were wearing this watch.
Yeah.
And I remember you taking it off your wrist and me looking at the case back. And we're going to get some...
I remember. I was like...
We're going to share that image now. But this watch is fire.
Yeah.
What was it about this piece? What was it about... let's hit a couple of things. What is it about Grand Seiko that does it for you? Start there.
I think it's niche, right? So it's not like the general public yet. They're kind of getting to it. Mm. But it was still, I think when I got into it, it was still kind of, it's definitely more popular now, but I think it was getting popular. And I really enjoyed that, one, their accuracy, but their dials.
Right.
Right? Like this red Matrix dial to me, this is something that I've never seen in any watch. As I've done research,
it's beautiful.
More and more on them.
It's crazy.
And then when you mirror it with the case back,
has a green jade rotor,
a 360 degree rotor.
Yeah, it covers the whole thing. It's not like a standard rotor on this watch.
And
it's
how the red and the gold, right? How the hands, it just looks, you know, perfect.
Yeah.
And I do like dates on my watches. At District One, you know, we buy a lot of shoes and write a lot of checks.
You need that date.
I need to know the date, and I forget all the time, but I always look at my wrist for the date. So I know a lot of people don't like dates, but I love
dates. Yeah, I was going to say, you have two watches with no date.
Yeah, but the majority of my watches have dates.
What was it about this piece that called you?
So, you know, you go into the rabbit hole of YouTube, and then you go into digging deep into a brand, and then you start wanting the limited pieces that the brand put out. Obviously, I have to like the dial, but I knew, I think this was limited to like 900 or something, 600. I forgot the number.
I think it was to Ginza only.
Yeah, maybe. And the retail on it, I got it for like $500 over its retail price, which I thought was really, really good for something that I wish I would have gotten at that time. You know, I just wasn't into watches when it released.
Yeah, right.
But when I saw it and I saw the price and the color of the dial, I knew that I probably wouldn't have another red dial in my collection. And that is the only red dial I have.
This would be the one.
It's the only one you need.
Yeah. You only need one.
You don't need anything else.
But it's something about having a red dial in your collection. I don't really see that often with too many people. So seeing that when I wear it, it's funny. A lot of people think it's like a day just and I get disrespected because I'm like, dude.
It's way better.
But it's just a beautiful dial. And
it really is.
That one is just the watch, man. There's not much story with it. It's just
you fell in love with it. Yeah. The first sight.
Sometimes it's the right one.
Do you have a strap for it?
I do. I put it on a strap and a bracelet because the Grand Seiko bracelets, as much as I love the brand, they're shaky.
That's something that we've talked about.
I usually put it, I have that right now on a green alligator suede strap.
Yeah. Ooh,
that's awesome.
Yeah.
Is that the one
it
you
reminds me of?
Yeah, I made it with John or something.
So our homie, I'm sorry. I'm blanking.
Which one?
We got a lot. Aurora.
Yes.
He has a red.
He has
dial,
a red dial. Datejust.
Datejust that he wears in a green strap.
Yep.
Very similar.
It's a good watch. The dial is supposed to represent bamboo, red bamboo.
Yeah.
That's why we call it the Matrix.
I've never seen red bamboo.
Well, I mean,
that's one of the best Grand Seikos to me.
This thing is beautiful. Well, when I met you and I saw you wearing this, I was quite impressed. I have to admit, I was like, this is a guy who knows.
Yeah.
He has taste.
Grand Seiko is dropping a new watch with that same dial pattern, but in green. We could just call that one the Matrix.
Yeah.
That's what it's called. I think it's called a Matrix dial.
They're calling the green one Urban Bamboo. That's from Grand Seiko. That will not stick.
So when I met you, you were purchasing a Tudor.
Yes, two Black Bay 58s.
Which one?
Black and Navy.
Two Black Bay 58s.
Yeah, the Black and the Navy.
Yeah.
Yeah, what was it about those pieces that caught you?
Honestly, the size. Yeah, I fell in love with how it fit my wrist.
Yeah.
I'm not, you know, really, I don't have big hands or big wrist. So when I put it on, it just fit perfect.
Yeah.
And then, you know, at that time, I'm not really too much into Submariners. I do have a Kerman and a Root Beer. Is the Root Beer considered
GMT.
GMT.
It looks like it.
Yeah.
But it's, I'm not like, I don't need too many of Rolex Submariners. But for some reason, the Black Bays, they fit me better.
Yeah,
than the
it's that 39. Yeah, it's like that vintage, 39 perfect, case man. With man. It's
and I have to say they're really accurate.
They are.
For the price,
yeah. Amazing. The value you get for the dollar is incredible. Yeah.
Tudor's also.
Shout out to Tudor. Tudor is today what Rolex used to be.
Yeah.
And that's why I love them.
And you don't feel bad wearing it. You don't feel like you got to look over your shoulder.
You don't, because most people are going to look at it and be like,
yeah, that's a fake Rolex.
Whatever.
Exactly.
But they don't even know. They have no idea.
So I love that. When I go into like watch stores now or something, like I ride a scooter every day, right? So a lot of people don't. I just like wearing certain things like that and walking into a watch store with a scooter just to kind of gauge, right?
But if they know, they know.
For sure.
That's a phrase that Rashawn uses often. If you know, you know.
Yeah.
And if I see a Black Bay 58 on someone's wrist, I'm like, they get it. They know.
Yeah.
This is a good guy.
Yeah. You understand that they're not just caring about hype. They actually
it's not hype at all. No. That's the thing.
But they were hyped for Tudor? A little bit. Yeah. The Black Bay 58 was.
Yeah, yeah, well,
that was their hype piece. Yeah. But in terms of hype, you're not even scratching the surface.
No,
it's cool because it's a little bit of hype, but it's still realistic. Like somebody can walk in and say, like, I want one. You might have to wait a couple months, but you'll get one.
The thing with what people don't realize is that every brand has their thing.
Yes.
You talk to guys in watch shops all the time, and they like to shit on other brands. Like, oh, like, who's buying a Panerai or an IWC? And it's like, dog, there's some IWCs and Panerais you can't buy.
Facts.
Sold out.
Yep.
Go try to get
so the cool thing about Tudor is that there's a number of them. Tudor has a bunch of things.
Yeah.
They got the Black Bay 58. Mm-hmm. They got the Pelagos.
Definitely the Pelagos.
Now they have the Ranger.
The Black Bay Pro, the FXD.
Like,
this is going to be a big one for them.
Yeah. This is a huge one.
This is huge for them.
Huge.
They're going to kill it with that.
I mean,
Ranger's going to crush too.
Ranger's going to crush.
The Ranger's $3,000.
Yeah.
I mean, the value you get from Tudor for the price. I mean, because it's, let's be honest. In terms of make, materials, it's a Rolex.
Yeah.
It's a fucking Rolex.
Well, the new Ranger literally has an oyster bracelet on it.
It's a Rolex.
Yeah, it's exactly.
It's a literal oyster bracelet.
It's a Rolex.
Yeah.
Which makes you feel good because the price is great.
Incredible. Yeah,
you don't feel bad.
It's a fraction of the price.
But what's also cool is that it's not a Rolex.
Yep.
It doesn't carry the baggage.
And if you own a Rolex,
you know exactly what he's talking about.
You know exactly what we're talking about because you know what it's like not to wear one and what it feels like not to wear one, but still wear something. And you're like, yeah, I like this.
Yeah. And you can also see that people definitely value them because they don't lose much of their value.
No, they actually retain value pretty good.
Which is great.
They either stay kind of consistent and flat or they appreciate it a little bit.
And that's what honest, I like about Grand Seiko too.
Exactly. And to be honest about Tudor is that over time they will all appreciate.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Hands down, facts, they will. If you have a Black Bay 58 in 10 years, you'll make a profit. Pelagos.
You definitely gonna make a profit.
Pro Ranger, etc., you'll make a profit in terms of value, right? Not that you want to actually sell, but it will be worth
just
more.
Just nice to know.
It will be worth more than what you paid for.
Security.
And the way that I see the brand going, this is just my personal opinion. Tudor will be, not only in terms of practice and make, but in terms of how they're perceived, they will be Rolex. They will be the next generation's Rolex, as you are unable to actually have access to one.
Yeah, if you can never get one.
But because to be honest, it's becoming increasingly difficult to get a Black Bay 58.
Mm-hmm. It is. I think
if we're being honest,
it took a little bit.
Yeah.
If you want a Pro, if you want a Ranger, if you want
a you can't even get that if you don't have a relationship or a spend history,
you're gonna wait for a Tudor.
Yeah.
And guys need to know that.
And well, how long did you wait for that?
So when did it come out? It came out
March.
And wow. I just bought it yesterday.
Wow.
So yeah.
Yeah, it's
in July.
3 months.
So yeah, 3 months.
And this is a guy who was on our show who has watches.
Yes.
Those guys.
Facts.
Crazy collection.
You know what I'm saying? Like an amazing collection.
And you have different tastes.
And he's still waiting.
All over the place.
And he still waited. You know, so don't sleep on Tudor.
No.
But continuing on.
What's the next watch that came after the Grand Seiko?
Okay, so I got my Snoopy.
Uh-oh.
There we go.
Okay, so just so all the people know, I did not pay retail. this was a very impulsive buy. I loved Snoopy. As a child, I had pajamas with Snoopy. I had a nightstand with Snoopy.
That's awesome.
I still got Snoopy pajamas. Yeah.
So when I saw this, I didn't know much about the Speedmaster. I'm sorry. But it spoke to me immediately. It's like when you know, you're like, okay, I need that. Yeah. Like there's no questions asked. So I got it last year. There was no hesitation. I just saw it and I was like, that's it.
Fuck it, let's get it.
At this point, this was my biggest purchase up to that point, financially. And I was like, dude, I don't want to buy this. You know, I never spent that kind of money in a watch. But I was just like, I went to Omega. They told me, hey, you might have to wait 5 years or buy something crazy. I was like, I'll just buy the watch at this point. Because the way they were making it seem, I'm like, I don't want to wait 5 years. I didn't have a spending history.
Watch is going to be around in 5 years.
Yeah. My point exactly. Ridiculous. And I knew that. And I know that down the line, this is going to be a very big collectible.
100%.
So as soon as I saw it, again, it just spoke to me. I love Snoopy. The movement on the back
is crazy.
Fire.
Best
fire.
Best case back.
Fire.
Any watch.
Yes.
And
hands down.
When I saw that, I bought it.
So
that back, I saw that. There's nothing that you have, anyone has that. You know,
but so Rafa actually has one of these too.
Yes.
Yeah, I got two good watches.
Yeah.
Well, this is a dope piece.
It's an awesome piece.
And I don't regret buying it.
I'm trying to get one now.
Good luck.
Yeah.
I have retail. I got a guy who's he's entertaining me. So we'll see if he actually comes through. Yeah. But if I can get one at retail.
I mean, this is something that
you hands have. Down.
It's an awesome watch. You want
hands down. After perfect. That,
okay, so we're going to get to the like.
So we're still in the chronograph. We're talking business.
Chronograph.
Another we're talking chronograph. Chronographs. Let's pass that Snoopy around real quick.
Yeah.
Right? So let's get that going.
So we went from an Omega and steel to a.
Right, so what exactly something is out of this world.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. That's a good pun.
So last year.
Rashawn would be proud of that.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. I'm shuttling Rashawn. Come on. Yeah.
So I used to see, like I said, Simon with the Daytona every day.
Yep.
And. It made me not want a steel Daytona just because I saw him with it every single day. And I was like, dude, give it a break. So then he bought the black one.
I mean,
and wears it now.
Y'all know how I feel about steel Daytonas.
Yeah. So
hater.
I was like, I'm going to do the complete opposite. Right. I saw the meteorite and I was just, so me and my dad have something in common. We both love outer space.
Okay.
I can watch outer space shows on Nat Geo on YouTube with Neil deGrasse.
Neil deGrasse Tyson.
And just, I can watch that on my day off, an entire day on black holes, the galaxy, everything. I just love it. So when I saw the meteorite Daytona, I immediately knew that I needed this. And I did get this at retail price, which I'm very grateful for.
You feel free to, you know, shout it out, you know.
So shout out to my guy who hooked it up. I didn't know you wanted to say it.
Yeah, I want the credit.
Get him.
Shout out to my guy Ben.
Makes it happen. I'm not gonna lie.
He makes it happen. And this was just something that with my connection with me and my dad with outer space, with space as a whole, I had to buy it. Just to have something that you know is not from this planet on your dial. And that you can look at. Also, the contrast is insane.
The meteorite and the yellow gold is crazy.
The meteorite on the yellow gold is, it just pops. It's something about that watch that I just needed.
And it's different because they used to make it with a silver dial. It does not compare to that at all.
No.
This is
the texture with the gold to me, that's literally on another world. I love that piece. And whenever I'm going out to a nice dinner or something like that, I'll pull it out. Yeah. It's just, it's much better than the stainless steel.
So I know you have also a Zenith, a rose gold Zenith.
Yes, I have the
an El Primero.
El Primero.
On a brown suede strap. And I know that used to be your date night watch for a while.
Rose gold,
so yeah. So when you got that, it immediately replaced it?
A little bit. But I mean, not really because.
You wear this on date night?
Yeah.
You get a lot of looks. Everybody know you go.
Also wear it to like a Sunday brunch.
Don't everybody Cipriani wear that.
Everybody's like, who the fuck is this guy?
Yeah. A lot of people don't know what it is. That's the best
part. But a lot of people do.
They do. The ones that do, they do.
That's incredible. I've seen a lot of watches, like collectors and at events and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever seen a meteorite Daytona.
It's literally not from this planet. You're not going to see one.
Yeah. And you don't see nobody wearing them.
Yeah, no.
So it's the beauty of it. And to me, the Oyster Flex bracelet, there's something about that.
You paid retail for this?
Yeah.
Respect.
There's something about that Daytona.
Who'd you buy this from? You got it from Ben?
Yeah, man.
Legend. So listen, ladies and gentlemen, this man bought a meteorite Daytona from Ben. So we are official tissue. If I can use a New York phrase again, we're official tissue. Yeah. Ben is legit. So
wait till this is the next one.
If you're not familiar with all our episodes, you need to watch everything before you holler at us.
Yeah.
Because we get it done.
All right, cool. So now,
I
got that in May. I actually just got that one in May. And then in
1 month later,
in June, I got a nice call. I was hoping to get a Patek, and I got the 5712. So again, it's not a watch that initially I even wanted, but as I started doing more research on this piece, and Ben kept telling me, trust me, you're gonna want it. You're gonna want it once you put it on. I was like, we'll see, because I really like the Aquanaut. But when you put this on,
you already had the Aquanaut at that point.
Yeah, I had the Aquanaut already, but when you put this on, it's a different kind of feeling.
My grail. And when you want attention, right now, and I'm like, oh god.
And when you want attention, you wear this because
this is beautiful, dog.
And that's amazing. And I'm really happy with this piece. I got it for retail price from Ben a month after the meteorite.
So I remember when I called Danny and I was like, yo, your 5712 came in. And he was like, I can't go get it. I got COVID.
Yeah, I had COVID the same day he called me. I'm like, bro,
he's like, yo, I just tested positive for COVID. Yeah. I'm going to have to pick it up. Like,
oh, you told me that story. I remember that.
Yo, and then we were talking. Conversation over. You know, well, we and Danny talk all day, every day. So that he goes on Instagram as soon as we get off the phone, and all of a sudden he just like spams me with like 5712 photos, and his, I get like three posts.
I had COVID and was very, you know,
he was bored. So he sends me like three posts about the watch, and then his only text after the post was fuck.
Yeah.
You know what's dope about this piece? There's a couple of things.
Only one, I was gonna say.
There's a couple of things. Obviously the complications. But the complications plus it's a micro rotor.
What does it for me on top of that is it's an asymmetrical dial.
Yeah.
The dial looks off but perfect.
Yeah.
If you look at
it's organized chaos.
Yeah.
No, it's beautiful. This is the Nautilus to have.
You know, and I think a lot of people like the plain one.
5711. Yeah, world goes
and
crazy.
And I see a lot of those and I'm like, I never get it for me. But they're so plain.
You know, it's funny because I love the 5167 and the 65 on Aquanaut plain just because it looks so balanced.
Well, I mean, you're going to share a secret now on the podcast?
I have a 5167. Oh.
That wasn't around
anymore. Yeah, I wasn't around. Episode. Well, yeah. So my wife and I, again, shout out to Nacha because it's technically hers. We have a 5167 and I love the plainness of it. But in the Nautilus, I agree 100%. I love the complication.
You need something.
I love like the
there's two Nautiluses that I like. There's only two that I've ever liked. 5712 is one of them. The other one's a 5740G. So.
Which is the?
The Perpetual in white gold.
Oh, that's the one I like.
Yeah, that's the other one you like.
Yep.
What they need to do is take the clasp from the 5740 and put it on all of them because this old ass 70 style bracelet is terrible.
Yeah, it's kind of hard to
yeah, put it, you know, yeah.
You feel like you got to push it when you want to open it. It's not like a smooth.
There's nothing about a Patek class or Nautilus class that's smooth.
Yeah.
At all.
On the 5740, it's fire though. It's a butterfly.
I haven't experienced that.
To the point, it's great.
But on the rest of them, it's always very cumbersome.
Yeah.
And you always feel like you're going to break it.
That's exactly how
don't.
I feel.
You don't.
But I always feel like I'm going
to
break
it. They're made
that.
Well, and I think that's something to speak to. Like, they're made well. You're not going to break it. But it feels like you will.
Yeah.
You know?
I will say, when I put that on, I remember Ben told me it was going to be low key. It's not low key, ladies and gentlemen. It is not low key.
I don't know what you were talking about.
I may not have said that because I wanted you to wear it to work.
Yeah, and I did. And I was like, okay, this is getting way too much attention. Let me go back to Aquanaut.
But it's crazy because, like you said, the Aquanaut flies under the radar.
Nobody knows. Nobody knows. But that piece is, you know, perfect. It's when you're going out, or you're going somewhere, it's a nice event. You know, it's a beautiful piece.
This is something you can definitely have to keep a flex. In your collection forever.
That's never leaving.
And the blue and the dial.
The Meteor Ray, the Snoopy, yeah. Never leaving. Those all mean something to me at different times of my life.
Man. I love this. You know? Love it.
Someday.
But I went definitely from a white, you know, snowflake to this in a year. So
from a white snowflake.
That's pretty good. You know, I got.
Well, we told you.
So talk about that a little bit. Let's talk about how, you know, the evolution of taste. What was it that influenced you to continue to go, and that helped you pivot?
So I think, first of all, getting pieces that I really like, not really on. You know, at first you feel bad spending on a watch. Like when you never did it, you feel really bad. You're like, why am I spending this? But then as you understand more about the brands and the history and just the conversations that you have with people that you would never talk to with these watches, it's what really sold me. So meeting you guys, right? Just meeting people that are in different points in their life.
Right.
I feel like when you meet people with watches, typically it doesn't have to be hype. It could be anything, but just to have that thing in common with somebody, it opens a lot of doors.
Well, we were talking about buying G-Shocks today.
Yeah, and I bought the G-Shock.
Yeah,
but there's something about you meeting people that you probably would never talk to if you didn't have it. 100%. That I'm really enjoying about the hobby. Yep. Right, it's not just the hype and like you see, I have different things. But it's that conversation that breaks out.
Yes.
It's like an icebreaker. There's no need to be a weirdo. Just like, hey, nice watch. We can talk now.
100%.
Yeah. It's so much easier.
It's all about relationships. I've so many friends, including you guys, that I met through this hobby and that I now hang out with, like, you know, weekends, like all the time.
Yeah, we got smashed last weekend. That was crazy.
But yeah, there's something I think we have to say. It's the same thing with sneakers, though. It's not necessarily the sneaker itself, but it's the people that are attached to it that you get to conversate with. And
that's what I love about it so much. And that's what's been so incredibly special about even like the podcast and the experience that we've had with it is all of the people that we've met and the relationships that we've fostered. But in addition to all that, the experiences. You know what I'm saying? And meeting all of these different people from different walks of life and conversing with them and connecting with them. And
also there's something about people like us collecting, right?
100%.
Yeah. That's what turned me off about watches before.
You didn't see a lot of us.
Never. So when I went to go get my watches and I met Chris and you, and I was just like, oh, like they look like me, right? It's cool,
and I think that's what's starting to wake up the watch world right now too.
Yeah.
Is the watch world for the first time is looking around, they're like, oh,
there's a lot more
people of color are collecting watches.
Exactly. And we're gonna make it pop even more.
100%. They know that.
You know, when we wear
they know that when we
wear things, sneakers, anything. Yeah.
They know that and they love it and they should. They need to embrace it. And
it's the future.
It is the future, because as any community grows, it only grows with diversity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. And when you have, and I think that's what's awesome about your story, is because you here you have a New York homegrown guy, right, who's literally flipped himself to the top to where he now has Patek, Daytonas, Aquanaut
and Oris
in his collection, among other pieces, right? And you're self-made, you're a humble guy, you're all about the community, you're all about the culture, and it shows people that like this hobby, this love for timepieces
for us
is not only for us, but it's not this pretentious, arrogant thing that exists for a selective few. That like there are real people that are involved in this.
Yeah.
And that's what makes it special.
Yeah.
Because it also gives someone, I mean, because we know people who are doing what you were doing today 15 years ago.
For sure.
Right? It gives them something to aspire to.
Yeah.
It gives them something to hunt down, to live up to. You know, and I think that's the incredible thing, because these are hobbies, these are trophies, these are all of those things.
Yeah.
And then, so, you know, to have a guy who's New York homebred, top to bottom, made sure. himself from the bottom up, you know what I'm saying, that people can identify with because there's a culture behind it. It's not just, not it's not trivial.
Well, that's the one beautiful thing I think about it. Like you said, I think it just gives, they are trophies, but it is something to look up to. And yeah. I think that's one of the dope, because I looked up to people.
Yes.
I was, when I learned about it, I was like, oh, he has this. But it, you start realizing, like, it's sneakers and watches are like this right now.
100%.
Right? I think if you really like sneakers and you have the, you don't even need the finances. You can wear a G-Shock. Dude. And G-Shocks are dope as hell. And
dope
I think
as hell.
When you have, you can get sneakers and, oh, G-Shock, and you could have a pair of $100 Jordans and a G-Shock, and now we could talk.
But here's the thing too, right? In the same way how, and I think this is the thing that's really cool. In the same way, like, you created your business, right? There's a kid out there that could start with a G-Shock and quite literally flip his way to a Patek Nautilus.
Sure.
If he goes about it the right way, thinks about it, studies enough, does his homework.
Not care what people think.
Not care what people think.
That's the hard part.
He could flip his way to a fucking Nautilus. And that's awesome.
Yeah. And enjoy it.
What advice would you give somebody trying to do that right now?
I think the first thing I would say is have a belief in yourself.
Yeah.
I really think that's important. But I'm really confident in, if I put my mind to anything,
you can achieve it.
I can, but I'm like, it seems arrogant, right? To like some people, like, but if you're not around me, you don't understand what I had to do to get where I'm at. Mm-hmm. And feeling as if I put my mind to anything, I will accomplish it. And it's not about the money necessarily, because I think a lot of people get it confused.
Sure.
It's the idea of just being bigger than most of the peers that I grew up with, because we just weren't given like any opportunities.
Yeah.
But when you get to a certain point in your life, you just feel like anything is possible. I really believe that. That's the first thing. Believe in yourself. And I think the second thing I really say is, you know, you really have to have tunnel vision.
Yes.
And I think it's difficult for people to understand what tunnel vision is unless you've experienced it. And I think tunnel vision means like, no, there's going to be a lot of things going on, but you should really focus on that one thing that you want to achieve, because you get distracted sometimes.
Yep.
And those... A lot of people now, they want to be the jack of all trades. Yeah. And I'd rather be great in one thing than good in many.
Yeah.
That is going to always pay off more.
Yeah.
Right? Like if I sold cars and watches and shoes, it would never be as good as me just selling, having a great store. And that one store is going to lead to this and that. And it leads to other opportunities. But it would have never led to that if I didn't have tunnel vision and was just so focused. And the last thing is just give back when you get something. Like don't forget that a lot of people out here, like, these are cool, but a lot of people can't. Right now, the economy's messed up. And, you know, we're talking about watches and everything, but you have to give back. And I think that's the number one thing I realize now as I get older. I mean, I take care of a lot of people, but I still find time to give back to homeless people, to people that need food, or just think, if I can always help and it's within my means, I'm more than happy to do. But give back. And I promise you, it'll come back.
It will come back.
It will always come back. And that's the one thing my dad taught me. Give and it'll come back.
Shout out to your pops, man. I want to say big ups to you and your story. Just as fellow New Yorkers, I think I can speak for all of us when I say we're incredibly proud of you.
Facts.
And your accomplishments.
Thank you.
Yeah.
You quite literally flipped yourself from $650 worth of shoes and losing $150 on all of them to owning this watch collection that you have. To fostering, continuing to foster an incredible culture in the store that you have, and providing not only opportunities for fellow New Yorkers.
14 employees.
Respect.
And they all look like us.
There we go. And but also to giving back.
Yeah.
And that means a lot to me. I know it means a lot to the guys that I'm sitting with today. And so just want to take this opportunity to give you your flowers. You deserve it.
Appreciate
it. As young as you are and what you've achieved, you have a lot to be proud of. And the fact that you're still out here looking to help and give back, I think speaks volumes. And congratulations to you. And I continue to look forward to seeing you grow as not only a business owner, but as a watch collector and as a friend.
It'll probably continue.
It definitely will continue.
Yeah, it's a hobby that
it definitely is. And you know, we appreciate you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming on board and doing our show with us tonight. And this has been amazing because we get to sit down with one of our own, one of our peers, someone who's close to us in age, our generation, and has done something that many would consider to be impossible. And you've achieved that.
Yeah.
So shout out to you. Shout out to your wife, because we all know what this is.
Shout out to my mom, too.
It don't go down. Shout out to his mom.
Yeah. Mama used to let me borrow the rent money.
Respect.
To go flip shoes.
Woo!
Every time. She would say, never do it.
Incredible.
So shout out my mom.
Incredible. But shout out to you, man.
Appreciate that.
For getting it done and doing the damn thing. And I don't know if you guys have anything else you want to share real quick.
Yeah, I just want to say that, I mean, to echo everything you just said, Danny's always giving back to his community, not only in the Lower East Side where District 1 is, but he's been on the news twice.
Yeah.
Like, was it Fox 5 or News 11?
Channel 12, I think.
Channel 12 did a story on him and the store and everything he does for the community. He spoke at his high school recently.
Awesome.
And I know for being a kid that dropped out of high school, if I had someone in my life like Danny who resonates with things that I've been through and I can relate to, maybe come speak to us, life would have been a little bit different back in those days. So I know that's super special.
I mean, that's very inspiring. With everything in perspective, Ben, life is not that bad for you.
It's not that bad. You know what I'm saying? High school is rough, dog.
But respect. Yeah. No, I feel you. No,
high school in Brooklyn is rough.
I know.
I know. I think something to say too is we don't all have to be basketball players and baseball. Like, we always want to be, you know, athletes when we're growing up, or rappers. And it's like, now you could actually do it a different way too. And if you realize where the real money comes from, it's really only 0.001% make it to that anyway. I think if young people learn more about business and entrepreneurship, there's way more avenues to grow 100%. Than just focusing on being a baseball player. Like that
and
was.
And I think the cool thing about you saying that too is because I think oftentimes with young people, and maybe I'm just the old person, I don't know.
You're
but I think I think oftentimes the young people, it's, you know, they want to be true to themselves. And I think what's cool about what you've done is you're not a rapper. You're not an athlete, but you figured out a way to monetize your interest. You figured out a way to monetize your hobby, the things that you love, and to show them that you can do that, right? Like, you know, maybe you're not the most talented athlete. Maybe you're not the most talented musician, but if you do your homework, you understand business, you're in tune with things that you love, you can figure out how to monetize
your own lane.
You can develop and create your own lane. And there's still space for that. There's still opportunities for that. And I think that's one of the biggest keys from your story that I take. And I think that other people can learn from. And I think that's incredibly inspiring. And I salute you.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
So for those of you who are listening, watching, etc., this is the Risk Check Podcast with Perry, Ben, minus Rashawn this week because he's still on vacation. He's out there surfing somewhere.
Enjoy your life.
But you know where to find us. On Instagram, you can find us at Risk Check Pod. On YouTube, Risk Check Podcast. Spotify, you can watch and listen at Risk Check Podcast. We're also on Apple Podcasts and Google Podcasts. We're on TikTok. Make sure you subscribe. Make sure you give us a good rating. Follow, like, share.
Yes.
All of the above. We're also incredibly reachable. You can find us on social media. Send us a DM.
My favorite thing to do now is talk shit in the comments.
Let's go. I mean, send us a comment. Send us a DM. We absolutely 100% will respond to you. We love engaging with our audience. And this is episode 31. We'll see you next week.
Peace.
Deuces.